Anton Di Pasquale is next up for Life Before Supercars. I wish I could be there because I love being at Dick Johnson Racing. I'm sort of virtually there, man in the iPad today. But Anton, your journey to get to where you're sitting right now is a really cool one. Take us back to when you've just won the Australian Formula Ford Championship. What was running through your mind in terms of summing up your career options?
We're going back a few years now. It's pretty surreal just being able to sit here and do this interview after, you know, a fair few years in the making. Back to Formula Ford, 2013, won the championship with Sonic. And it probably started even a little bit before that. In your second year of Formula Ford, you're looking at options. It's all going quite well. You're sort of thinking, what next? You know, this at that point, there is a fair few different options. And really got to know Larco during that year and had a few chats with him. And then he sort of opened our eyes to what there is possibility to do. Ended up going down the European path. But probably before that even, I actually went to the US, did a test over there. In that Road to Indy program stuff. And in hindsight, that probably could have been a better route, like the way it all worked out. But end up going into Europe and sort of don't regret it, but had an awesome time. But did first dabble into what possibly could be in America and then ended up going to Europe after that. And then it's been a cool, amazing journey from then.
What was Larco's advice at that time when it came, you know, time to make the decision, Europe, America? How did he sort of coach you through that?
Larco was out there to help out. He's an awesome fella. We all know him and all know him on TV and his racing and everything else. He just seen what I was doing and I think he sort of took an interest and wanted me to go somewhere and do something well. So that was really cool to have him, you know, and have someone like that being able to help you. And he sort of then stroked the deal to go to Europe and found the team with Lechner and then find the championship for me to race. And then helped us make that decision. And it turned out, you know, the best one for me. He kind of just sort of helped us on the path and he knew a few people, spoke to some people and kind of did the stuff that we had no idea what we're doing. You know, we're just racing, having a good time. Open our eyes to that. And his, you know, his advice, and it made complete sense, was, you know, you go there, have a crack, and you can always come back to Australia, like it's not going anywhere. Because obviously Super 2, Porsche and all those kind of things were also options. It was quite cool and an amazing experience for, you know, imagine a young fella. I'm just won Formula Ford Championship, just graduated high school. Go to Europe, you know, fresh 18, so legal to the world, and get to move overseas and never done anything like that before. So to be able to do that, and don't, like, obviously the parents had to stay home and work and still help me fund what I wanted to do. They handballed me off to the EU and off we went.
So where did you base yourself out of? Because Lechner, they're an Austrian team, weren't they? So how did that all work? Most of the young guys end up moving to England. How did you sort of figure out where you wanted to go?
I've just always had an idea of basically whatever team I'm racing for, wherever they are, I think I should be close by, because that's sort of, you know, and especially moving across the world, going to be racing with these guys and they're the ones sort of help look after me. So I had an awesome relationship with the Lechners, and they sort of, you know, as soon as I landed, they sort of sorted me from then, got me a car, sort of got me around, sort of showed me where to go, introduced me to people that I'd, you know, need to have friends in Austria. So I lived just out of Salzburg, which is just by their factory, which is just by the Red Bull headquarters. So a little town called Fuschl, which is just by a little lake. And there's massive Red Bull, and it's basically Red Bull people everywhere in terms of the workers and stuff. And yeah, just that Austria, amazing place, a beautiful place. It was really cool.
So did you get a bit of an idea at that point that maybe trying to become a Red Bull Junior or something like that may have been an option?
It was always an option. It's always an idea. Everyone wants, you know, at that time, any young open wheeler racer wants to be a Red Bull Junior or a Ferrari Junior or something Junior. I did do some a sim stuff with them before we went to some race somewhere more the next year. But yeah, at that time, I was just enjoying my racing. The idea was to go and do this championship, go well, move into the next thing, sort of respect the process and go through that path and just basically listen to the people around me. And yeah.
Well, that first year in Formula Renault did go very well. You cleaned up. First weekend in Zandvoort, you seemed to be on the pace straight away. Tell us about the year 2014.
Probably one of my probably best years racing. It was such a cool time. Obviously just moved overseas. I've done that whole big step and then went to a team with Lechner, which is a massive worldwide team, more in Porsches and stuff. At that time they weren't doing any open wheelers, so they just got back into the junior open wheeler scene. So there was no real understanding before we started how we would go. We just assumed and we made that calculated decision. They've done it before and they're racing at a high level across Europe in Porsche and stuff, so we'll be able to do it. And they put everything into it and gave us an amazing car, which made my job a little easier. And then going to Zandvoort for the first time, you know, racing in Europe, such a cool, iconic track. It's probably still my favorite track. I mean, other than Bathurst probably is triumphs anything, but Zandvoort definitely, other than Bathurst, is my favorite track. I've always had good times there. But yeah, just being able to do that and race over there and then be successful, I guess, was, you know, a big thing, because you made that whole step and you put a lot of effort into it. So to be able to be successful was amazing. And it's sort of a lot of credit to the people that helped me get there, for sure.
In 2015, you upped the engine size in the Formula Renault, and you also upped the competition, didn't you? Because you were in a very serious team with some pretty big teammates, guys like Jack Aitken were in there, who's now a Formula One test driver or reserve driver. Dan Ticktum, who was a Red Bull Junior as well. What was 2015 like, and how tough was that competition?
It was at that time, Renault 2-litre was like, you know, the championship. You go there, you spend your, sort of like DVS in a way, like you kind of spend the most probably amount of time in that category. So these guys were in there for 3 years or so before I rocked in. So I had, you know, plan was always to be there for a little bit of time. But it sort of didn't end up working out. Probably didn't make the world's best decision. I think there's probably decisions, we probably could have made a better decision in terms of where we went and the way we went about it, but that's, you don't really know until you do it. So in hindsight, we probably could have done some different things. We still learned a lot, raced at such a high level with some really cool people, and then ultimately didn't have the money to do anything else with it, but took that experience and learning back to Australia and to where I am now. It sort of shaped the rest of my career up, for sure.
At the end of 2015, what was on your plate in terms of decision making, and what ultimately kicked it to come back to Australia? Was it just funding, or what was that moment like when you decided, all right, time to come home?
Yeah, I guess the ultimate decision was, you know, obviously 2014 was amazing, and 2015 was always going to be a harder year because you're going into sort of an established category with established drivers. So it was always going to take a little bit longer. But then we kind of made the decision that didn't have the budget to do too many more of that. And then even if we did that, to get to the next level and get to, you know, your GP3, GP2, you know, another 4 years or so, whatever it works out to be, we definitely don't have the money for that. So we probably just made the decision just to call it earlier than what we probably had to. But then the setup, my career in, you know, a more realistic world, which was Australia at the time, into my next part of my career, and that worked out. And then sort of popped back into Super 2 again with Larco, then introduced me to Paul, and then sort of started that next part of my career.
You've come home, Larco has introduced you to Paul Morris. What was meeting the dude like?
So pretty interesting. Obviously come back from Europe, you know, obviously disappointed not being able to sort of continue on over there. You know, it's a little bit of heartbreak for a young fella to come home, even though you love your home. There was obviously options again in Australia. That time you got Super 2, sort of Porsche. That's kind of your two routes. So Larco suggested to go spend a bit of time with Paul at Norwell, do a bit of driving with him, and then go from there. So essentially went out to Norwell, met Paul, did some driving in his SS Commodore at that time. This is sort of going back before 86s and things like that, so it's all a bit different now. But yeah, I did some laps with Paul in a Commodore, and sort of my first tin top laps, essentially, just around Norwell. That relationship went really well straight away. I just come from, you know, obviously Europe, done a lot of stuff with the FIA Academy and stuff over there, part of that program. So I've done a little bit of the stuff already, so I had an idea of, you know, basically how to understand and listen to the coach next to you. From there, we basically did a heap of stuff together, and then Paul sort of suggested to do some laps in his supercar, which he sort of stopped racing at that time, which is then the car which Brock raced, which is now the car Nash is racing. So cool car, which is an XDGR car too. So from there, went out to QR, I did some laps in there, and then From that point onwards, kind of went, you know, Paul sort of took me under his wing, sort of said, you know, I'd like to get you to supercars, and this is how I think you should do it, and this is sort of with the budget we've got, which is not very much, do this, do that, and then we should be there in 2 years kind of thing. This is just sort of trust the process. So yeah, from there, essentially, just sort of listen to everything he said. He said, you know, look left, you know, blah, blah, blah. So, and then ended up being right and worked. So managed to get in the supercars from there. So went obviously in the first year in the Blueprint car, which was like, you know, there was obviously the first year of car, the futures in Super 2. So we'll never win in races. We'll never on pole position just because the equipment you're in, but we had Paul Dunbrough, which was still in the old car. So he was sort of our benchmark the whole time. And then from there, got the car of the future next year, had a cool group of people help me get to that point and get the car and all that kind of stuff. So yeah, and then basically that sort of then opened the doors into Erebus. And then, which in hindsight, having that European experience, then I think fast-tracked me in front of a couple guys, just having, you know, been able to been over Europe and do some extra stuff. Barry took a liking to, which gave him a shot in supercars, which is really basically Paul's plan, sort of just play that out, and it worked, which is really cool. And then now he's sort of doing that for some other young guys, and sort of from then, you know, the Norwell Academy and all this stuff is forming really well, and we're able to get Brock into supercars now. And then you know, the proof's in the pudding, the process works. You just got to listen and learn. It's cool.
You know, finally looking back at the awesome experiences that you've had, is there one thing that sticks with you from your time in Europe that you'll remember forever, whether it be a race win or a place that you went or a night out with some mates? What is it that sticks with you from your time in Europe?
There's a few nights. I think I was very fortunate. I lived the first year in Austria, which is like the most beautiful place in the world, you know, edge of the Alps, you know, sound of music, all that kind of stuff. So amazing scenery, like perfect family holiday. But as a young fella, it's not like that much, obviously, party scenes and all that stuff. So it was pretty dedicated, training, all that stuff. And then the next year, got to live in Spain, in Barcelona, which was a very different demographic again. So I got to experience sort of that two parts of Europe. But yeah, in terms of the racing, I think just, you know, I think 2014 is probably my most memorable, just because obviously you generally try and remember success more than when you don't go that good. That's just natural. But we had some cool times. You know, that the Lechner family was just amazing to us as drivers. They treated us like with heaps of respect and gave us everything we needed, and just sort of took us under because they knew that come across the world to race. So sort of was like their other kid, and really, really liked that time. But yeah, I think just all of it, it's something that, you know, if you can do it, it's, you learn so much from it, just even if it's not from a racing point of view, just as a life point of view, you know. So just moving across the world, you know, just moving through airports where you can't speak the language, you know, all that kind of stuff is things you tick off, and you come back a different person. So I think that sort of shaped me up as the person I am to get into now the DJR Shelby Pro Racing, you know, just sort of shaping you up for where you want to go. And I think that all sort of stems back from then. So yeah, I mean, there's so many learning you have throughout your career, starting go-karting, your parents, you know, you learn from everyone. But I think Europe, yeah, probably shaped me up the most to who I am now, which is, yeah, which is awesome. Even though it didn't turn out how, you know, you want your dream to work out, it's still a dream to be racing as a professional racing car driver.
Awesome. Love the chat, Anton. Looking forward to getting back to racing, and congratulations on the success that you've had at such a young age. Well done.
Thank you, Chad. Thanks for chatting, mate.